Well, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. It's a true pleasure to have Professor Michael Grubb here with us today, but do let me start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land that we meet on, the Ngunnawal people, and do let me welcome you all to Crawford School. Now, Michael is a true leader in thought, in research, and in policy advisory on climate change policy, climate change economics, and where energy meets climate change. He's been influential in the UK, in Europe, and in fact globally for, I think, well over two decades, Michael. He's worked as an academic at Cambridge, at Imperial College. He's had posts with Chatham House. He's been chief economist of the UK Carbon Trust, and he served on the UK Committee on Climate Change, among many other things. These days, he's Professor of International Energy and Climate Change Policy at University College London. He's a senior advisor to the UK Office of Gas and Electricity Markets. He's also the chair of the UK Government Panel of Technical Experts on Energy Market Reform. And that's, of course, a topic that that is beginning to be very hotly debated in Australia. Today is the kickoff, I would say, of Michael's Australian tour. There will be lectures, small roundtables with experts, as well as discussions with governments in several of our capital cities. The timing really couldn't be much better with the release of the terms of reference for Australia's federal government's climate policy review, that release of the TOR just yesterday, and of course the initial report or briefing papers from the Finkel review of the national electricity market to be released to COAC leaders this Friday, and then presumably published sometime after that. So really no better time to hear from someone who's been through many of these policy discussions and intellectual endeavours in that sphere of where energy meets climate change concerns, meets the issues around low carbon transition, than Michael Grubb. Now, the title of tonight's lecture is Delivering the Energy Transition in Theory and Practice, Planetary Economics and the Three Domains of Sustainable Development. The subtitle refers to Michael's very large book, a very deep book, if that is a word to describe a book as well. I think, Michael, you will be touching on the themes of the book, and I think the book is available for sale tonight as well. If you're lucky, you might even get Michael's autograph in it, if you get one. So we'll take about three quarters of an hour for Michael to give his public lecture here tonight, which leaves us ample time for a really good question and answer session. So please join me in welcoming Professor Michael Grubb.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Frank. Thanks to you all for coming. And I'm going to try and take you on a bit of a journey, which has taken me a long time, and the lecture risk taking a little while. But it's through both the theory and the practice of what is now, I think, widely recognized as an emergent and maybe even once in a century energy transition. The practice I want to illustrate primarily with experience from the UK, where there's been certainly a lot of interesting things and both good and bad lessons. And I want to follow that through into some of the wider international themes. Now, I'm well aware in reviewing this talk, I realise I'll probably, again, try to pack a little bit too much in. I want to make one scene-setting comment and then be a little brief on some of the theory so that we can get to some of the real experience. The scene-setting comment that I will start with is just to remind us all that in dealing with the energy issue, we have at least three major objectives we're trying to deal with. You have to maintain a secure system, it has to be affordable, and it has to deliver ultimately environmental objectives, which you can also frame as being partly about environmental security. There are various aspects amongst those, and I'm sometimes asked, and there's been certainly political debate in Britain, well, actually, how do you rank these? Which is the most important? And there's a sense in which, you know, you can't do anything unless you have security, but the real point is it's a slightly false issue, because if you focus on one of these to the exclusion of others, the others will come back and bite you. And this is a sector that requires long-term transformation, long-term investments, and the worst thing is instability and veering from, oh God, security crisis, oh no, we must deal with carbon, oh no, it's all too expensive, let's change everything. That's the worst place to be. If you want stability, you have to address all three of these simultaneously. And what that means is you have to be thinking about how can the system change and evolve to deliver all three of those sufficiently and satisfactorily. I am going to focus primarily upon electricity, which is the area where I major, but as one aspect we'll see is electricity starts to engage much more with the other sectors as well, other energy. So I'll skip straight through these slightly strange diagrams, because this overall, and if people want and come back to me and ask a bit more about what the stuff in the middle means, but in the interest of marching through a fair pace, what is going on in this diagram is trying to represent is that we have a number of different underlying economic processes going on in this space. Now, for those of you who are well-trained economists or familiar, it's really the middle one that you're most familiar with, which is broadly where people and actors are behaving in a sense as rational man, typically homo economus, i.e. planning, thinking, calculating, optimizing. What's my least cost maximum welfare? And we've built a huge body of neoclassical and welfare theory around that kind of behavioral structure, that kind of behavioral assumption. And broadly, the theme here is that everyone in the system is optimizing based on economic criteria. But that's not the only thing that actually goes on in our societies, of course. Actually, we see a lot of people, a lot of entities, a lot of organizations, a lot of countries that are actually real-world behavior is more to do with behavioral instincts, habits. It's got a horrible term, this area of satisficing in economics, which is broadly people, I think it was a term that was coined about 50 years ago to explain people seem to be satisfied with not actually optimizing, not getting the best they could, either because they just don't know, or they're not paying attention, or they're so stuck in existing habits or existing technologies, they never get out of that rut. They're existing somewhere to the left of the best, making the best trade-offs they could. Now, in the book, this becomes rather important, these distinctions. Rather than have other, you know, definite terms, I simply say, let me just call that, let's start with reality, right? The reality is most people are creatures of habit, inertia, incomplete awareness of our opportunities, and I'll call that first domain. And we've now had several decades and Nobel Prizes awarded to people looking at behavioral economics, etc. That means a second domain where people actually are properly optimizing, rationally thinking, etc., in economic terms and economic assumptions, and broadly doing so assuming existing technologies, or at least they know the technologies of the future, that's kind of second domain economics. That's the language that I introduced to be really clear and specific. There's something else going on, which is, of course, technologies move, evolve, improve over time, and the interesting thing is, how do they move? How do they evolve? In what directions? With what characteristics? What drives the engines of innovation? And along with it, infrastructure and so forth. Now, there you're in a world where technologies are changing, evolving. You can shape them. You can shape the systems. And there's, again, a corresponding on the bottom here, evolutionary economics, institutional economics are areas that try to get to grips with those kinds of phenomena of how systems and technologies change. And in the book, which is what I then label third domain economics, which ultimately is what's involved if you're trying to transform systems. Now, so already I've said, okay, folks, there is more than one theory we need to work with here. In fact, there's at least three distinct areas of theory. And I am not interested in the debate as who is right and which theory is right, because actually these describe different processes over different scales. So as one's moving from the left-hand side, you're looking at relatively small units, how individuals behave, small organizational units. And in the middle, you're looking at how market structures behave, how companies will plan strategically invest, maybe whole market assumptions. And on the right, you're potentially looking at global phenomena of technology diffusion and so forth. And similarly, timescales evolve. You look at the timescales of these kinds of behaviors here, what are the paybacks you hear on energy efficiency? Typically months to a couple of years. You look at how markets think and plan, maybe a couple of years, a couple of decades is the typical time horizon. You look at all of the phenomena around systems evolution, complex technological change, new industries emerging and falling. Certainly in big sectors, engineering-intensive sectors like energy, you're talking about a decade to a century. Even the most profitable things, like discovering oil and the motor car, took about 3/4 of a century to diffuse. So what you're really talking about here is different kinds of processes that apply depending upon what scale of the system you're looking at. And by extension, this is not a debate about which theory is right and which is wrong. It's about what's the nature of the problem you're looking at and the question you're answering, and so which kind of these areas are you actually in and need to get to grips with. And what is significant about the energy and climate area, and this is what I think makes it a bit unusual and very difficult in public policy terms, is this is a problem which simultaneously expands the decision-making of 7 billion individuals, most of whom are not actually waking up in the morning paying attention to their energy and thinking, how do I optimize my energy use today? At the same time, you are trying to transform some of the most complex systems humanity's ever developed and interrelated systems of technologies, infrastructure, etc. So we are intrinsically dealing with a system which spans its whole range of 7 billion individual inattentive decision makers wasting energy and investments for a 50-year time horizon of how might this whole system evolve. Also worth saying that in practical policy terms to date, despite all of the theory that many economists have thrown at this problem to say what you really need are markets and pricing and carbon pricing, which kind of has an interesting history in Australia, and most regions have actually made a lot more progress on energy efficiency policy and on technology or renewables policy, rather than saying, we've got a market, we're all good economists, let's put a price on the damage of climate change and the system will sort itself out. It's not actually worked like that anyway. So we should pay attention to that effect. Now, that's relevant and it maps very much onto the theory. And I say, I'll just in the interest of time, you can probably figure out what these graphs in the middle mean from what I said, but I'm happy to come back to that. What I do want to do is move a little bit on to how does that theoretical framework say, yeah, there's multiple things going on at different scales, so what do you do about it? Well, what you need to do about it is to think, okay, what kind of policies will impact on what kind of decision areas? Decision frameworks. So for the economists in the room and many others who've been through the Australian debate, you'll be well aware, indeed when I was in Australia 10 years ago, it was like all anyone wanted to talk to me about was carbon pricing. We're on energy market and we have a climate problem, so we need to put a price on carbon emissions. That's the rational thing to do. There's lots of theory which says why that's the rational thing to do. That will solve the problem, shouldn't really do much else. And what this is saying is, yeah, okay, fine. Where you are dealing with, if you like, the well-behaved markets part of the behavioral system, then, and i.e. dealing with optimizing behavior, conscious optimizing behavior, then yes, in principle, that would be the kind of policy approach of maximum relevance. We know that markets, under the right conditions, are by far the most efficient way of allocating resources. providing the prices are right. Therefore, you need liberalized energy markets and you need to get the prices right, which means factoring in the cost of carbon. Now, you can also use that policy tool to try and address some of the other stuff. If you jack up energy prices high enough and fast enough, you may kick consumers into noticing they are wasting a lot of energy and they could do something about it. The problem is, rather than doing something about it, what they're most actually likely to do is to vote you out of office. And it's actually a very blunt kind of tool because the whole point is you're dealing with opportunities which exist precisely because people are not the rational attention-paying optimizers that the theory was assuming. So what we actually know is in that kind of area where you're dealing with that kind of behavior or these structural barriers, it's not just personal behavior, it's things like tenant-landlord split. The people who own the building maybe don't pay the bills. The people who pay the bills don't own the building, so they can't do anything about the insulation, etc. Lots of contractual failures, organizational failures. Those who know management theory will understand principal-agent failures, all that kind of stuff. Very often, actually, you know, you're best off just to set a standard. Just say you've got to build buildings with a minimum level of energy performance or appliances, etc. Or you need to have a very conscious engagement strategy to enable people to become more aware of what their opportunities and potentials are to reduce both energy costs and emissions. But it's a whole different policy talk. And in effect, what you are then trying to do is drive the system towards, frankly, making smarter choices. And it's astonishing how many opportunities there are of that sort. If what you're trying to do is transform the system, then you have to get involved in, we are using the book, the term strategic investment, which is effectively any investment, I can define as economically very clearly, any investment that yields a positive social benefit, i.e. it's good for society, that cannot be captured fully by any individual private actor in the market. I put it like that, it's obvious that there's loads of them. We do it all the time. Think education, think roads, think lots of things. We're not so used to thinking about it in this kind of area, but the same principle applies. There are lots of potential investments which have a higher public return than anyone in the market's going to get. So there's an obvious case for public involvement in encouraging, funding, shaping, orienting those kinds of strategic investments. And the simplest examples, indeed, are innovation and infrastructure. So what I've done here, quite simply, is create a very basic matrix saying the world is complex in the sense that there are these different kinds of processes going on, and therefore you need different kinds of policies attuned to the kind of behaviors that one is trying to influence, in this case, in the context of energy and climate change. And I will come back to this sort of structure of thinking, just in wrap-up remarks. What I want to do before I get into this sort of the application, though, is show a couple of features of, first, some data which shed an interesting light on some of this stuff and how it relates to both the political feasibility and the wider economics. So the piece of data that I want to offer you is the following one, which is vertically showing average energy prices in different countries, and horizontally showing average energy intensity, the amount of energy that countries use per unit of GDP. Now, first point to make is, of course, the amount of money that a country spends on energy is the product of the price and intensity. It's price times volume. The dotted line on this graph is the line of constant energy expenditure. And so what you discover, for example, is that Japan, in the top left there, has energy prices that are more than twice as high as the United States, and yet expends exactly the same amount on energy. And so does France and Germany. They lie bang on that line of constant energy expenditure. And indeed, most of the, what we think of as the advanced industrialized countries, spend pretty similar amounts, even though energy prices differ by more than a factor of two. There's quite a few features and things you can do with that. And one observation is countries that actually subsidized energy and kept it really cheap on the grounds that cheap energy was good for consumers, good for people, good for economic development, have ended up spending a lot more on energy because actually what it bred was tremendous inefficiency, poor infrastructure, a lot of waste, and when they simply could no longer afford the level of subsidies involved in keeping energy cheap, actually it was incredibly painful. Many of those countries of the former Eastern Europe, former Soviet Union, spending twice as much on their energy, twice as much of their income on energy as the countries I just mentioned earlier. And so, of course, it's a lot tougher to talk about environment and the costs and pricing of anything because it's genuinely higher. But that's a classic example. Now, one thing that shows is in the very long term, price really is important. And it's something that in the book I've called the Bashmakov-Newbery constant, because there were two different researchers that were sort of stumbling across this constancy of energy expenditure. And actually Bashmakov suggested that that's actually been true for more than a century for most countries, despite huge variations in energy prices, given sufficient time of the system to adjust. Now that's kind of interesting empirically also because there is a literature on how economies respond to energy prices, and it actually doesn't end up with that kind of answer. But it tends to be looking at much more micro. If you put up your energy price by 10%, what do consumers do? Oh, they reduce demand by 2, 3%. Well, the data I just showed you was said, no, actually, you end up with 10% lower energy consumption if you have 10% higher energy prices, which is why you end up with a constant. What is going on is when you actually look at the national level, you discover countries like Japan, when the oil price shocks hit, they didn't just sit there and take it on the chin. They went out and did strong efficiency programs, strong efficiency standards. They invested in new innovation, anything to get away from oil, high-speed trains, etc. In other words, the practical policy response was a three-pillar policy response. And typically, that is what you see. Now, in theory, you could try and deliver energy transformation with respect to climate change by jacking up the carbon price so high that you would force countries and systems into doing some of these other things just because it became so expensive. Again, the problem is the government would get thrown out of office long before you got that far. So what we have to do in policy terms is to actually engineer policy consciously across all these three pillars in order to achieve the same result. And you have to drive the energy transition with those multiple pillars for several decades and without relying on political untenable price shocks, in other words, whether it's from carbon prices or from renewable support costs going through the roof or whatever. Just one final point about the theoretical structure of this, which is that I kind of work through this sort of very much bottom-up microeconomics approach to how you think about what's going on, what needs to be done, but then finally link it back to big, broad macroeconomic debates, which got kind of interesting, and I worked with a colleague, Jean-Charles Lacard, on this. Because when you look at what economics has had to say about economic growth over the last 5-6 decades, it's been driven by what was called the solo growth model, primarily, which says, okay, here is a mathematical way of representing the accumulation of capital investment, accumulation of resources, etc., which explain growth, except that when you go and measure it, you discover we've had twice as much economic growth as a theory like that can explain. Solo himself did the calculation and called it the solo residual. What else is actually driving growth? Well, the answer was, seems to be something to do with improving structural inefficiencies in the system, and something to do with innovation and education, the infrastructure that goes along with it. So in other words, sort of making the theories of economic growth add up to meet the realities we observe inherently involves these first and third domain processes, as I call them in the book, which is kind of quite neat as a sort of theoretical observation. Part of the challenge is We don't have adequate policy in these areas, in my view, and by that I mean adequately understood the roles, partly because we rely a lot on computer modeling, and modeling is really easy if you're in a second domain world and you assume everybody's a rational optimizer and you can do all these fancy calculations. We don't really know how to model these first and third domain processes very well. So as things churn through the policy political analytic system, they tend to get slightly sort of, well, you know, not that well articulated, shall we say. And I think energy is particularly important in energy, again, for several reasons. It's got characteristics which tend to lead to structural inefficiencies in energy systems, we could come back to. We've got the instabilities of fossil fuel markets, you've got low rates of innovation, and yet energy is an input to lots of other things in the economy as well. So inefficiencies tend to propagate. So I think there's a reason why one gets drawn to this kind of broader theoretical framework when you have to tackle energy issues, and that feeds through also into actually the role of energy and growth, and actually getting better at the energy sector may be economically beneficial. So that was a quick canter through a few hundred pages of theory. What about some practice? Well, let me draw on a UK example, or a few aspects of UK energy policy, just partly because that's what I've experienced most closely. As a precursor, though, sorry, I should have put this one before. As a precursor, let me just emphasize something that emerges about the nature of what we are trying to achieve with respect to energy transition, particularly concerning climate change. What this attempts to show, this graph, is that we're in a process of evolving. Just think of the, like, time is coming towards you, and we have two routes, two valleys emerging that we can try and follow. One of them is we're going to need some sorts of new energy systems, and on the right, you can develop that with more fossil fuel resources. We've spent a lot of time and effort finding new ways to get fossil fuels out of the ground to convert it. We may need sort of coal to liquids technologies. You can do lots of other stuff in a high carbon way to meet the needs of 10 billion people this century. Alternatively, you can try and develop systems in a low carbon direction, the sort of green futures, which tend to be more emphasis on innovation, biomass, maybe electricity in transport, integrated electricity systems, smart electricity, consumer engagement. These tend to be more capital intensive, but very low operating cost. Now, the point is, what's on the left is not just a slightly higher cost version of what's on the right. It is a fundamentally different kind of system that is being created. The way that I've drawn this quite deliberately is to suggest, do you know what? We don't have any very fundamental reasons for assuming that the left is more expensive than the right. It's very different. It will have different economic characteristics. There is some research to suggest that actually the most expensive thing is to get stuck in the middle and have a kind of half-developed carbon-intensive system and a half-developed low-carbon system. The challenge, though, is that for quite deep structural reasons, we tend to follow the valley we're in. And if you think about what's happened over the last 10, 12 years or so, I recall 2003, 2004, quite a lot of my economics colleagues saying, do you know this climate problem and governments aren't being terribly good getting to grips with it? What we really need is an oil price shock. That will solve the problem. That will drive up the cost of fossil fuels. Then we'll get the low carbon economy. Well, we got an oil price shock. It was quite a big one for those who recall and remember the sort of 2006, 7, 8 oil prices going up north of $100 a barrel. Did we get a low carbon economy emerging out of it? No, what you discovered is actually that digging more fossil fuel out of the ground got a lot more profitable, and so you threw a lot, the industries threw a lot more resources at working out how to mess up the atmosphere a lot more cheaply. That's basically, the amount of money that went into doing that was quite extraordinary because that's the business they were in. They were not going to say, oh, my core product's got a lot more high value, so I'm going to move into alternative industries. They said, this is the business I'm in. I better do it better, and I better find more of this stuff. And there are lots of structural things that tend to keep you on the track you're in and imply that to get into the other valley, you have to cross the ridge in the middle. And that is going to require a strong push from public policy. And that ultimately is the challenge then that we're facing in public policy terms. Or have been. So, to now move a bit more on to the UK example, but with this hook at the bottom, which is a quote from well over 2,000 years old from Seneca. No wind is favourable to those who don't know where they are going. If the system is transforming, it helps a lot to know what kind of direction are you trying to evolve it in. Well, in the UK, we have tried to give some direction to the evolution of the energy system through something called the Climate Change Act. Worth noting, incidentally, the UK is a bit of an odd country to be doing this, you could say. It was once upon a time called an island of coal in a sea of oil and gas. Slightly odd place to try and pioneer low-carbon economics. But actually, for various reasons, we had UK emissions coming down from 1990 quite significantly, a move away from coal and particularly got out of coal mining during the 1990s. And what the Climate Change Act does, it was adopted in 2008, and it said, right, the anchor point for UK climate policy, for UK energy policy, is going to be an 80% reduction by mid-century. That's a big ask, but it really sets a strategic framework. And then there was a legal structure built around that based on the fact that the government has to adopt carbon budgets, i.e. a legally binding limit on UK CO2 emissions in 5-year periods. And I've shown on here the trajectory of the first 4 carbon budgets, and then the 5th one in blue, which was recommended by the advisory committee and adopted by the government in June of this year. And that sets out the binding reduction for the UK of 57% below 1990 levels for the 5-year period centred on 2030. So, you know, it's a significant trajectory to be on. We have delivered, over-delivered on the first 2 and clearly will do on the 3rd carbon budget. The 4th gets tougher, and I will now, in a moment, turn to some of the policy dimension to delivering that. But the point is there's a legal framework that says we're going in this direction, and there's a supporting infrastructure. I could say more about the kind of mechanisms to try and keep us on that kind of track. In terms of some of the components, first that have gone into that history of emission reductions, emissions come from lots of different sectors, right? The blue line shows that the reductions in the 90s were significantly because of industrial restructuring, got rid of quite a bit of relatively inefficient industry, a certain amount of offshoring as well, and that's a separate debate about how much is the UK reduced versus imported. Happy to take questions. We had an initial dash for gas, that's the red line in the power sector. Waste made contributions. The point is, actually not much of that was really climate policy. Some of it was free gifts from other things and reducing structural inefficiencies in the UK economy. You see continued reductions here since 2008 and the introduction of the Climate Change Act, and most recently, power sector emission reductions. Now, before I go into the policy landscape, I think there has been a gradual migration away from things that just happened towards things that were consciously part of climate policy. And part of that has been around energy efficiency. So the first pillar of policy, and I won't go in much depth here, but I think it is common sense, but also empirically proven, that the right kind of energy efficiency policies based on standards and labelling and engagement can be very effective. What we've actually seen is, based on just appliance labelling, we started out with a lot of rubbish in the system. We labelled it A is the best through to G is the worst, and within 10 to 15 years, actually almost everything was A, so we had to introduce new classes of A+, A++, and A++++. And it's been very efficient, except that we started out with the labels in the wrong place. We've done other things as well, as in Australia and others, a sort of supplier obligations, have to invest in their consumer reductions. We've had an interesting story around something called an energy efficiency scheme, CRC, for like the retail sectors, for less energy intensive sectors, which, if you like, was taking this behavioral analysis and applying it to companies who had 300 retail stores across Britain and didn't have a clue what their energy consumption was, because it was just written off as an unavoidable cost. And it put the focus on the central company level to say, what are our emissions? Go buy allowances to cover it and explain to your publics why you're emitting so much and why some of your facilities are emitting 10 times as much as other things. It was actually quite a powerful instrument. We then, in 2010, 2011, tried something else, which said, you know what, actually, let's just treat our consumers as rational, thoughtful, optimizing people. Let's set up a structure to help them get loans to improve energy efficiency of their buildings, and the loan can stay with the building if they move, and that should really lead to a full, cost-effective, rational solution. We'll call it the Green Deal, and it's great. It was a huge embarrassment, total flop in public policy terms. And the reason is actually very, very simple, which is it took a second pillar assumption to a first domain problem. It assumed that people were rational cost optimizers, and given this finance structure, they would go, oh, I can save some money. Actually, people who'd been ignoring their energy consumption continued to ignore their energy consumption. It was really not rocket science, but it was, in my view, an interesting example of how much we'd kind of, some parts of the system were trying to assume that everyone was rational cost optimizing when they just weren't. And energy efficiency, for multiple reasons, is replete with those kinds of opportunities and those kinds of policies, successes and failures. I could say more about the evolution of efficiency policy, but I don't want to drag you into unnecessary detail, but I think it's quite nice, having got that framework, you can take one look at an instrument and think, yeah, that could make sense, or no, that's just not going to work. Understand the decisions that you're trying to influence. If I move on to the sort of second pillar, the markets, the pricing, the et ceteras, in the power sector particularly, I'll spend a bit longer on this, partly because I've been deep within it, so I kind of like talking about it, partly because it is important, partly because I also know in Australia now it's quite important. A word of background about the UK power sector. These graphs here are the different power sources. In 1990, roughly, we liberalized the power sector, introduced competition into a system that had been totally dominated by coal and nuclear generation. And lest anyone get any mistake about my sentiment in this area when I say liberalization is not the answer to everything, it really was a very good answer to the problem we had at the time, which was a centralized system that thought the only way you could generate power was either a coal or a nuclear power station and nothing else could work, which is pretty much the mindset at the time. Well, after we liberalized the system, partly for structural reasons, we had a spate of gas investment, that's the yellow, a rapid increase in natural gas into the system, multiple reasons going on at the time. We discovered various problems with the way that we had done liberalization. For the geeks here, we had an electricity pool. They then changed that to put emphasis on bilateral trading arrangements, really trying to force the electricity sector to be as much like a competitive market as it possibly could be. And that was actually great in some respects, and prices came down quite a bit. They came down quite a bit partly because nobody was investing in anything, and it's actually fairly easy to bring down prices if you don't invest in anything. So that then began to build up a concern that actually we were going to face a security crisis because nobody was building new plant under this highly competitive structure. And that, combined with the rise of carbon concerns, is what then led the UK into a process of energy market reform. Now, just a word about the context here. The UK was very proud of its liberalization, and I think in a number of respects, rightly so. It was therefore a bit of a shock to many people to discover that we were deep in a conversation of how do we get out of this and into something different. And there were two big inputs to that transformation. One was the UK energy regulator basically saying, if we don't do something, the lights are going to go out because people are just not investing. The coal plants are getting old. Some are going to be retired. Nuclear, likewise. We have a major investment problem. The other thing was the Climate Change Committee, the advisory body under the Climate Change Act, saying, do you know what? This low carbon transition involves potentially £100 billion of investment. Almost all of that is in highly capital intensive, almost cost nothing to run plant. And the market that we've got is just not going to deliver that. Or if it does, it will be very inefficient because it's high risk, high volatile electricity prices, and you're expecting to just the private sector to bankroll it all up front, with all the risks being borne as to what the electricity and carbon and fuel prices happen to be in the future. So all the risk is loaded onto things that they have nothing to do with the technology you're investing in, which is very inefficient indeed. So something has to be done if you're going to get this kind of investment to happen. So those two streams drove the UK into the energy market reform program. What did we do? Well, there were four pillars to this. Contracts for difference, which I believe here in ACT is now a familiar thing for those in the field. I'll say a bit about it. Something called the capacity mechanism, payments for firm delivery of power. A carbon floor price, a minimum price on carbon emissions in the power sector, and an emissions performance standard, which in effect made it illegal to build coal plants. The way the contracts for difference work, for those not familiar, it's actually a sort of fixed price contract. It says, well, you get revenue from the electricity market, which is the blue thing there, but will guarantee a top-up to a fixed price. For renewables, it's a 15-year contract. And initially, the government tendered out the contracts, and then they went for a more competitive auction. That, in time, has actually yielded some quite big cost savings. I don't want to talk you through all the numbers here, but there is various evidence that the certainty given by 15-year contracts, when combined with the pressure of competitive auctions, so you have a competitive pressure, it's a kind of market, depends on whether or not you want to call it a market, certainly competitive, actually drove substantial cost reductions in this system. And we found a whole range of renewable energy technologies coming in significantly cheaper than people had expected or predicted. There were other factors going on, of course, in the wider world, technology cost reductions. Other European countries have been proceeding with renewable auctions in the last just 18 months since the last UK one, with further substantial cost reductions. And expected that even offshore wind, which is widely seen as the most expensive of these, is now going to pretty much halve its price within the space of 5 years or so. That has been broadly a positive experience, and after a certain amount of political turmoil, the UK has announced it will continue with this structure. Another aspect, I mentioned the carbon floor price, and so I wanted to show you some data as up-to-date as humanly possible. What this chart shows is coal use, coal generation in the UK power sector in 2012. You get the annual cycle. We obviously burn a lot more in cold winters than in the summer months. And you can see a dramatic downward trend against that cycle. And yes, this is an axis that goes from zero. So earlier this year, we had the first coal-free day of UK power generation for more than a century. From the combination of nuclear, gas, and renewables. And what's been driving that? A number of things, the rise of renewables that I've just flagged, the fact that gas prices, which had been extremely high, were coming down, and the fact that the EMR introduced the carbon price support mechanism 2013, and its level doubled in April 2015. What that combination has done, and the price, incidentally, is now, price of carbon in the UK electricity is, what, 35 Australian dollars or so per tonne CO2. And what that does is it basically makes it cheaper to run the gas instead of coal. Coal is twice as carbon intensive. So suddenly you flipped the system over, and then the coal is having to go in only after the gas and being knocked out by both improved efficiency and renewables. Its space is getting squeezed. So volume's going down, profitability is going down. We've seen several coal plants close, a lot more due for closure or likely to be closed in the next year or two. And in that sense, we've been through a difficult transition, but it does show the importance of price in the areas where price really matters. And if you're running power stations, the operational price, the relative prices, absolutely matter. So it looks like the UK is well on track for quite a major transformation of its power system, with coal rapidly on the way out. The UK has been by far the most sort of aggressive in this transformation, but overall coal generation across Europe went down by about 10% in aggregate from some of the combination of forces, but in most of the rest of Europe, not much impact from the carbon price because there is a European system, but it's a very low price at the moment and likely to stay so until there's a sort of political conditions to fix it. So, having mentioned price in the market, let me also stress there's price outside the market. The UK, this is a projection of what some of that price would need to be, but what it actually tracks is a UK government carbon price, which is applied to all decision-making by public authorities in the UK when they have to do their regulatory impact assessment, cost-benefit assessment. So in Ofgem, our regulatory decisions fed into the model this carbon price trajectory as a tool of public policy planning to be consistent with the Climate Change Act and our international commitments. And I think we underestimate, and I think one of the mistakes we've made in some of the economics debate in this area is assuming that there was just one type of carbon price and it had to be in the market and had to be either a tax or a cap and trade. Actually, again, deconstruct the problem. There's lots of actors in this space, and quite a lot of them can do things with just a number if they know what number to use and build into their investment appraisal, their risk appraisal, risk management tool, or their just public jurisdictional responsibilities. And if you think you've got a 50-year problem with climate change and you're taking 50-year infrastructure decisions on how you develop a city, for example, and its transport system, makes absolute sense to assume a certain cost of carbon. And that, I think, is an area which I hope we'll see coming back more, or taken up more in public discourse. Now, I should keep an eye on the time, but I did want to stress when I now go to the innovation space, it doesn't mean I've abandoned the idea that prices matter. Of course they matter. But to do innovation well, you need a lot of other things, and you need to be thinking about transformation. Now, again, the merging of data and theory, just very briefly, slightly complex chart, but what it effectively shows on the right is data on innovation expenditures in different sectors. How much do sectors spend on research and development? And the answer is, well, some sectors, the ones we think of as innovative, spend 10 to 15% of their turnover on research and development. That's like pharmaceuticals, biotechnology, software, IT, so forth. Highly innovative. Continual churn of ideas, new products, etc. Unfortunately, in this area, we're trying to get radical innovation in sectors like, oh dear, what do we have here? Gas, water, multi-utilities, electricity, metals, construction industries, all of which spend less than 1% of their turnover on innovation. Well, if that's the current situation, why did anyone think that trying to introduce a carbon price or shift relative prices would lead to fundamental change? It doesn't. They're structurally not very innovative sectors. There is a theoretical explanation developed in the book as to why that is the case. Without going into too much details, here you've got pretty fast product development cycles and lots of consumers who are willing potentially to spend an awful lot more for a radical, exciting new product like an iPhone, and therefore big profits to be made. Down here, In the energy area, maybe talking about long, complex, expensive and risky hardware, and you end up going to the market and saying, hey, consumer, I've got a radically new electron that I want to sell you, and it's actually exactly the same as all your other electrons. We've just made it in a different way, but please spend five times as much. It kind of doesn't work as a business model, right? So you have this thing that people in this field call the technology valley of death, hence the problem I alluded to earlier. You tend to get locked into what you already like and know and do, and new innovation has to be forced in with a substantial government engagement. Now, that is, the government engagement needs to be at both ends, the technology push end and the market pull end. When we come into the renewables area, we have actually had big government intervention driven mainly by feed-in tariffs and other mandated to help pull technologies through as well as the R&D end. And two observations. One is there was quite a lot of criticism of this stuff. People said, well, this is a crazily expensive way of reducing emissions. Well, yeah, if you assumed that there was no innovation, it would have been. But of course, the whole game plan was to drive new technologies and sectors and industries. And it succeeded. It succeeded big time. This, for example, is the complete collapse of solar cell costs. Really quite a remarkable cost reductions going on here. Here is equivalent in, even in battery technology, which is, of course, an important complement. That has transformed the possibilities for development and economic development in much of the developing world, which, of course, much of which is sunny. So we have a whole new set of possibilities that have emerged globally thanks to these fantastically inefficient investments by kind of German consumers and others driving cost reductions. Of course, it's a more complicated story than that. I'm not going to talk you through all of the numbers on this, which basically shows cost trends in onshore wind, offshore, and solar. So here you see the radical decline in solar costs over the last 5 years. Significant decline here. But what this does is it takes actually a full range of costs. And it says, do you know, we can pick out the best, which are right down here in 2016, great cost reductions. But there's still huge ranges. Why is there such huge range in costs? Actually, it's not primarily to do because there's good and bad technologies and people still doing lots of both of them. It's more to do with public policy risk. Bear in mind, as I said, a lot of this is very capital intensive. You spend all the money up front, and it then costs almost nothing to run. What's the cost of that? Well, tell me your cost of capital, and then I can tell you what the cost is. If I have to pay a 3% rate of return, this could be really cheap. If I'm going to pay a 10% rate of return, this is really expensive. That's what you have going on here. To a large degree, it's a reflection of policy risk. So in Germany, people trust the government. They know it's committed to renewable energy. Capital costs 3%, and it's really pretty cheap. Not that far away in Greece, continual economic concerns, unstable policy environment, cost of capital 10 to 15%, renewable energy is really expensive. So tell me your policy landscape and how much industry trusts it, and then I can tell you what the cost of renewable energy is. It's a very important message. But technologically, we have now broken through the valley in the middle. What we now have to do is get more sophisticated about the systems that accompany this transformation. And sorry, this is a slightly compressed diagram. Interestingly, I found, what it shows is a conception of distributed service providers in the kinds of electricity system that are beginning to emerge, where you have lots of local, you know, metering, automation, electric vehicles, smart, this solar generation, smart meters, smart appliances responding to the value of electricity at the time, and lots of local integrated distribution systems. It's the kind of smart electricity system of the future at the local level. And it's emerging, and interestingly, this chart, I found the best one came from China. They're all over this stuff. That does not mean that cities can provide all their own energy. And I think decentralization is part of the future, but it is not the future, because the fact is big cities in particular will still need to get a lot of the power from outside. And in Europe, we're looking at the other end of actually a serious proposal from an energy regulator to say, do you know, in the middle of the North Sea, we've got the Dogger Bank, it's not very deep, it used to be land before the Ice Age, and we could just build an island that becomes a manufacturing hub for rolling out wind energy in the North Sea. So what you're really seeing is hollowing out of the electricity system. It becomes a platform from which you trade electricity between the big and the small and trade services across it. Radically different from the electricity systems of the 21st century, which are basically build me enough networks to get power from big central power stations to the consumers. So, stressing the theme, you start technology change, you find you're talking about systems change, and really quite substantial system change, and very interesting areas. You will have to go beyond the power system. You'll need to extend, for example, electricity into transport sectors, which means that, by the way, your batteries start coming for free with the car when you plug them in, and that becomes part of the new system that you're evolving. Now, having scampered through a lot of that, let me finally start building us back towards the kind of policy frameworks that support this to make just a couple of key points. Underlying this kind of transformation, the kind of supportive policies, if you like, to drag us across the ridge into the low-carbon valley, does need an integrated framework across these three pillars of policy. So here are basically the three pillars I alluded to. This is broadly the standards, the engagement practices on energy efficiency, getting the markets and pricing signals right, getting the strategic investment for innovation and infrastructure. And they're not in isolation. They all go together, and you think about the relationship so that energy efficiency, for example, reduces consumer bills that enable people to potentially cope with rising prices. Bear in mind that Basham-Cogh-Newbury constant, you want to keep the bill constant even if the prices rise. And then the markets and the carbon pricing potentially, for example, generate revenues with which you can fund the innovation programs and also start to reveal the costs of the technologies emerging. Can they compete in the market given a certain element of carbon pricing? And it enhances the value of low carbon innovation. Here you're getting technologies developed that feed back into the system that enable people to escape the more carbon intensive parts of the system because they're getting more costly. And again, the carbon pricing element of the system can rise attention and deliver new products for consumers and potentially finance energy efficiency programs, for example, to vulnerable customers and others. And even better if you can get connections directly here. So think smart Californian consumers buying the first hybrid vehicles. Think smart technologies, control technologies, enabling consumers to be much more aware of and have more control over their energy consumption. So it's a package deal. And getting that package right is at the heart of transformation policies, and that applies, as I say, across the individual components, but also an industrial strategy, which has just become an acceptable word in Britain again, that aims to lower resource costs, tackle materials consumption as well as just energy consumption, and accelerate innovation in all of the kinds of new industries that emerge in this kind of transformation. I will skip over actually saying more about carbon pricing. I've probably said more than enough for an Australian audience on that topic. Let me have a just draw your attention. The point is basically saying, yeah, there's lots of stuff around here. We thought about it the wrong way. We thought about it too narrowly. We got the narrative wrong, etc. The key point is, when you think about this integrated package, you are no longer in a world that says, oh, climate change is a burden and we have to negotiate how you share that burden. You're in a different world in which you're saying there's really interesting opportunities here, there's transformative process that require investment, along with the investment will come benefits, innovation, economic returns. What do I need internationally to support my domestic efforts in these areas? It's a different question. And you don't need the whole world on board. In fact, frankly, economically, to be crude, you might quite like to have a small, you know, a club that can establish an industrial leadership in some of these areas. But you probably do need to be thinking about a coalition strategy for strengthening the implementation of the Paris Agreement and enhancing the level of ambition. So as we start to close the gap between the goals of the Paris Agreement and the actual offerings that countries so far have on the table. And I think that that is entirely possible given this kind of economic framework. But what you do have to do is think about how do you coordinate the pricing elements, the technology investments, and the trade elements of such agreements that you basically make it more attractive to be in than out of that kind of arrangement. So it does change the international thinking about the strategy. This is no longer a burden-sharing challenge. This is a totally different kind of problem and potentially a more promising one. I'll skip that, just straight towards my conclusions, which is, in a nutshell, the 21st energy systems will be radically different from the 20th. They will not be the same systems with other costs imposed on top, quite the reverse. Understanding a transition on this scale means broadening economic horizons to consider and understand all three of those domains of behavior and the associated pillars of policy matched to the behaviors you're influencing or the processes. The transition is already underway, and in fact, as far as I can see, it's accelerating, and non-market policies have so far had more impact than the pure market policies. In some regions that have helped to lead this, like Germany, the cost impacts have not been trivial and arguably pushed towards their limit, but the resulting technology advances really now place the transition within reach of global development and with more balanced policy packages. Clear policy direction can shift the risk. And I've talked about a technology transition, a systems transition. We really now need the risk transition. It must be more risky to invest in the fossil carbon-intensive stuff than low-carbon-intensive stuff. And I have illustrated, if you get the financing confidence right, how relatively cheap that can end up on the low-carbon investments. And I think that we will have to now soon return to some of the debates around carbon pricing as a part of that process in whatever forms are appropriate to the political and legal circumstances of different jurisdictions. And I think that's probably more than enough from me. And I hope I've left some time for some questions and discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Michael, for what was a sweeping tour de force of climate change policy. And it must be an interesting feeling to have been here 10 years ago and all that anyone was talking about was carbon pricing and to see that now rather completely, comprehensively off the policy agenda. But seriously, I think your message of the need for a holistic approach to a policy package to get to a lower carbon system is one that will be very positively received and will be constructively discussed in your meetings in Australia. Let's throw it open to questions. We've got about got about 20 minutes.
Thank you, Professor Grubb. Would you care to comment on the Australian government's proposal for spending its infrastructure fund on a new railway? Could 21st century technology to support a coal mine, which is a new coal mine, the world's biggest. How's that for innovation?
Well, if you're going to spend money on rail infrastructure, I'd have thought you wanted it between Sydney and Canberra as your first priority. I mean, I think history's going to look back at this period and try and think, why did so many governments or companies spend so much money on stranded assets? Need I say more?
Right. Okay, so really helpful to me if you indicate to me when you want to speak next, that speeds it up a bit. You are certainly invited to tell us who you are and who are you with. That's also helpful for the discussion. And I think I mentioned at the start that copies of the book are available here, and Professor Grubb is making them available for his author's cost price, which I think is about $50 or thereabouts.
Hi, my name is Carl Titterman. I'm studying energy policy over at the Fenner School. Thank you for your presentation. It's been fantastic. I'm just wondering your thoughts on, I suppose, the subsidisation of fossil fuels currently. I'm unfamiliar with the UK, but Australia are obviously pretty keen on it.
So I didn't hear the very last bit.
I just said that I'm not sure about what the UK does, but Australia are pretty keen on it.
I think I can say that there's no coal subsidies in the UK. In fact, precious little. There is some elements in offshore, and subsidies and costs are quite complicated in the energy area. Partly because you look at oil, and typically a lot of countries have done some subsidy for oil exploration, but they also tax the stuff to high heaven at the pump. So you end up with actually a pretty higher price. But it varies by country and structure and definition, because the most common definition of subsidy is the difference between a domestic price and an international price. So we'll discover that with the collapse of international energy prices in the last 2 years, subsidies have miraculously gone down. It doesn't actually mean anybody's changed anything very much. That said, absolutely subsidies still exist. Subsidies reflect history and political and institutional interests. Frequently, energy security is a kind of cloak for some of those interests. There are maybe legitimate concerns as well. And there have been big push in the G20 to get agreement on phasing out fossil fuel subsidies, with, I think, some significant progress, but it's still quite slow and patchy. The fact is, there's the old saying, all politics is local, and local industries can lobby very hard and effectively for some kinds of state supports. I'm not sure what I can add. Politics of this was never easy.
All right. Thanks, Professor Grubb. Excellent talk, full of colour and movement and lots of clear diagrams. Terrific. My name's Marita Bradshaw. I'm a recovering petroleum geologist. Well, you know, the guilt I feel. But to follow on from the last question, this thing about subsidies, and, you know, still trying to have our cake and eat it, which we tried to do in Australia by putting a lot of effort into carbon capture and storage.
Yeah.
And I see that's still part of the UK policy. Now, do you think that rather than having these non-policy instruments that subsidise renewable energy, if we had have gone 20 years ago or 10 years ago for a pure carbon tax, would the CCS thing would have worked, or was that always greenwash, or is it a bit of both?
Well, there's kind of two questions rolled into one, at least there. Your comment about if we go back 20 years, if we'd had an adequate carbon price, reminds me of when I gave a talk along these lines in the US. One of the reactions is, well, all this strategic investment stuff is government involvement and it's dangerous. Actually, we should just have a high enough carbon price, like $100 at least for CCS. And I just thought, what kind of planet are you living on? You're sitting in Washington and you're saying, oh, you don't do this stuff, you should just have a carbon price of $100. Well, to me, that's a recipe for, well, we're not going to actually do anything. Because clearly you're not going to have a carbon price. You might as well admit it. You're not going to have a carbon price in the US of $100. So why even say that was really what we should do, even though I think the framework I outlined is it's not even the most efficient thing to do. What you'd actually want is a technology development strategy alongside a slowly rising carbon price, such that once the technology had matured to the point of real commercial viability, then it met the carbon price. The evidence is for CCS, you probably need a carbon price in the region of $80 to $100 to make it fly once the technology is mature. That may be wrong. I don't know. I don't know quite how innovative we can be. What I do know is a couple of things. Of course, there's a strong industrial interest in CCS because it's the one that technology that enables the fossil fuel industry to continue to use its comparative capacities and advantages and infrastructure. The other thing is, it's the only one amongst all these technologies which you absolutely know is going to be more expensive than the carbon system without CCS. All the others, you can speculate whether or not renewables can eventually get cheaper or not, etc. But if you take a fossil fuel plant and need to attach a lot of other equipment to it, you can be fairly sure it's going to be more costly than just having the fossil fuel plant. Now, I've got mixed feelings about CCS. I have had for a while. I think there's a very good case to say it will be essential. You just look at Asia and coal capacity and so forth. On the other hand, it does feel like it's just sort of reaching for the politically easy fix, which has turned out to be actually in practice very difficult. We've been talking about CCS since I came into this business. That was a quarter of a century ago. And it's beginning to feel like fusion power, you know? Fusion power, you know? Yeah. No. I want to be a bit careful. There is a growth of some elements of the C or the C or the S in lots of different places. I think about 20 plants that sort of put themselves under that label. The most famous is Norway, or famous because it's been running 20 years. But that's the separation and storage of stripping gas out of a gas stream. It's not a power plant capture or industrial plant capture at all. It's been driven by the Norwegian carbon price. That's why Statoil do it. It's been a very successful example of that interaction. But it's not going to help us, you know, get carbon out of coal power or industrial facilities. The UK did make a fairly big push. It committed in principle £1 billion to a CCS plant and finally cancelled it about 3 weeks before they were due to sign final contract, which was a real shockwave through the system. And the argument for cancelling it was partly, actually, we might be better off spending R&D money on more fundamental innovation around renewables and batteries and smart systems, and lots of other possibilities, maybe radical new chemical transformation technologies, when even the people involved in that CCS plant say it will only fly if we have a carbon price of $80 to $100 because we don't think we're going to get there. So that was the argument. I'm not saying whether that was right or wrong, but at the end of the day, a fiscal crunch, that was the thing that was canned. And probably all I can say is don't look to Europe for CCS developments now.
I quite like the thought experiment because if you take that seriously and say, okay, well, so what about 10 years ago you had a comprehensive carbon price of a level in between CCS and PV additional costs. Mm-hmm. You might have got, you know, significant investments in CCS power plants and a much slower uptake of PV, right? A much slower decline in costs.
Yeah, you might.
Thanks for the talk. I just wanted to go back to your theoretical framework, I suppose, about the three domains. And so I think I've found your framework quite resonant for talking about applying different schools of economics, I guess, depending on the scale of the problem. And I think this idea that you've put out about second domain's logic to first domain problems and things like that is really resonant. I think through this talk you've focused a lot on the problems of the first pillar and the third pillar or the third domain. But I was wondering if you would be able to shed a little bit more light on the sort of problems of the second domain and where. Like, what are the sort of problems where you think the optimising frameworks and the best practice frontier sort of are more relevant?
Are relevant.
Yes.
Thanks for that. And obviously, one of the slight frustrations of a talk like this is one could go into enormous depth on any of these, so I just tried to give you some flavours. There is, and in the book I use the theme, there are... whilst you need an integrated package in the system overall, you can identify sectors for which one domain is more relevant than others. The example I use is the building sector is the archetypal one for first domain stuff. lots of structural inefficiencies in how we waste energy in buildings. Third domain, transport, is archetypal because we're really looking at a fundamental revolution, if you will, electric vehicles, charging infrastructure, etc., etc. The industrial sector tends to be the archetypal second domain because a lot of the investments are absolutely planners doing lots of cost-benefit calculations, etc., etc. And so relative prices really matter. What I think, however, in that area we have not paid nearly enough attention to was the sophistication of policy, including being very clear about what are you actually trying to achieve with the instrument. Is it an operational change? And I've shown you the UK results, and we finally got there for really quite big operational changes driven to an important degree by a carbon price. But it's still, frankly, very small beer with respect to investment. Now, if you're talking about investment, you're talking about actually what do companies believe about the next two or three decades, even, in relation to the carbon price. Having a system like the European emissions trading system, where the price is sort of, well, it did that, and then it collapsed, and then it did that, and then it's collapsed, for those who've seen it, is completely useless for investment purposes. It's been operationally great at the times we had a significant price. If you are actually wanting to use the carbon pricing for investment purposes in these sectors, you have to think about how those decisions are made, the timescales over which they are made, the risks attached to it. Where that personally leads me is that in terms of the actual in-market carbon price, which again there are various variants, there's a lot of merit in a hybrid system. You know, you do have some form of cap and trade, but you bound it, you have a carbon price corridor. And that's not hard to engineer in policy terms. I could say load more about that. But also, you bear in mind, there's lots of other ways carbon pricing can come into decision-making. I gave the example of the social cost of carbon that's used in UK government decision-making. The US Treasury has a social cost of carbon. The European Investment Bank does. The World Bank finally introduced one about 2 years ago. The International Finance Corporation is beginning to seriously think about it, and that will start to roll out in the private sector as well. Companies are using an internal carbon price as a risk management tool. Increasingly widespread. And you can have hybrid things. You could write contracts for power generation or for steel manufacturing, even low-carbon steel manufacturing, which had a contractual link to an assumed carbon price underwritten by the government in the contract. So I think we need to be much more imaginative about ways of introducing it. And of course, the intensity scheme here, I was somewhat bemused looking at the press yesterday to discover that half the press said, right, never again a carbon price, and the other said, oh, we're just going to have a look at a carbon price again. Yeah, it will generate a price, potentially, if it's well designed, and maybe in quite effective ways, but we have to see how that plays out.
Half of the press is owned by one owner, and the other half is owned by another owner.
Again, thanks for your talk. Colonel Ian Cumming, the Defence Force Climate and Security Advocate. I want to twist the argument a little bit about public policy, if I can, for a moment. Executives of cigarette companies maintained for a decade or more that there was no problem with smoking cigarettes. Yet we've got policy makers and policy decision makers sitting on a hill just near us who know that there are problems, but they're not making policy. I think what you've delivered to us is three segments, what looks like market segments, rather than the policy makers and the way they make policy. Do you see the Australian government sitting in one of those three sectors? And how do you change their minds, potentially, with a view like a cigarette company executive might have?
I have a feeling that people in this audience can answer that question better than I can. I can't comment on the political processes here. They've clearly been rather complex and interesting to an observer. The tobacco analogy is quite interesting. It's partly interesting. It's interesting in lots of ways. it's over 50 years since at least the US Surgeon General said unambiguous evidence smoking kills people. It took kind of 50 years to get through the transition. And the transition involved all of the above, behavioral staff, branding staff, public education, economic taxation of tobacco, eventually nurturing a combined process of social change and business change. I said, you know, this is really not a sensible thing to be doing so much of. And I think that the fossil fuels process will, to some degree, follow similar tracks, but even tougher. Where the government sits, well, if there's one thing I've learned, it's there's very rarely a single uniform entity called a government. There are lots of different departments, different interests, different people, different politicians, and I will merely watch with interest how the Australian system evolves. How's that for dodging a question?
Michael, we'll just take two quick questions and answers because we don't want to keep the younger members of the audience much past 7 o'clock.
Yeah, I know. Okay.
So our friends from the CSIRO first, and then John Sibley from the ACT government. Then we'll wrap up.
I've got a question about the sort of two valley model, and I was wondering if there's any research that you're aware of that gives an idea of what sort of features one should be looking at in a policy situation to identify when a given policy might be enough to drag you over that hill into the next valley. Versus when it's just not useful at all to just nowhere near enough to get you anywhere.
Ooh, that's kind of an interesting question. I think one of the virtues of some of the renewables demand pull programs is that they were clearly on a scale. Or the level of subsidy or scale of targets and ambition, that basically we're going to force the system over the ridge, at least in volume terms, and it remained a bit of a gamble as to how much would costs come down, but there was a lot of evidence around economies of scale and learning ratios and stuff that researchers do to suggest that you would expect substantial cost reductions, and that's what we've got. And I think that has been enough to get us over the hump on renewable energy in principle, providing that you do, providing you acknowledge that you're not just having a different technology for the same system. You know, still, I think if we remove, despite the huge cost reductions, I still think renewables would struggle if all you've got is a short-run spot market in electrons, because for the reasons I hinted at in terms of where the risks fall. If you have a system entirely based on long-term contracts, it'd be the other way around. Now renewables would win all of the long-term contracts and fossil fuels wouldn't get a look in because the risks would be placed the other way around, and I could elaborate on that. So I think that's an area where we have successfully pulled our way across the ridge in technological terms, and the question now is how much systems and policy will follow in that wake, to make sure that we properly get embedded down that kind of system. Other areas, transport, it's pretty hard to gauge, I think, at the moment, but clearly we do see a lot of promising developments in electric vehicles. In the UK system, the bit we're most worried about is heat, and to some extent the manufacturing industries, although I think we're seeing our way a bit more towards on that. Better ideas and technologies required in the heat sector is one thing beginning to come through.
Catherine Smith, CSIRO. Thank you very much. This is probably a long question. Very happy with a two-word answer. But you didn't speak about the shift to a capacity market. And no. I'm interested in your view, support in theory and in practice for the UK's implementation.
Oh, boy.
You can just go good, bad, yes, no.
Well, the problem is neither good or bad would actually capture the answer. I think there's a reasonable case why we've got a capacity market, but they are dangerous things. I mean, I've kind of, for those not familiar, basically you're paying for the existence of plant that could generate if you really need it. And I found myself calling it the nuclear weapon of energy policy. be bloody careful how you design it and use it. And maybe I have to keep it there given the time.
Thank you, John Sibley from ACT Government. Thank you, very interesting talk. I guess the common theme is that you've kind of repeated is you want to have a very clear view of what you're trying to achieve with the future, and sometimes that, through the presentation, sort of becomes mixed up in my mind with particular technology outcomes or what kinds of human behaviour expect and this kind of thing. Whereas I think in Australia, in sort of orthodox policy circles, it's more about focus on what the actual problem is, which is the carbon emissions, and don't try and be prescriptive about anything else. That's why we keep going back to the carbon price. But I'm just wondering, is that oversimplifying what you're saying, or are you saying that we need to have more focus on and a clear view of more than just the need to reduce emissions? We need to imagine this sort of industrial sector that's going to do that decarbonisation.
Yeah, it's a very good question and probing. Let me just give an example, which is very much the theoretical view that I think in a lot of European policy making circles and certainly regulatory circles was precisely, look, okay, we have a carbon problem. Let's focus on the carbon problem. Set a carbon target or a carbon price or a combination, but don't get messed up with technology picking winners and all that stuff. And I actually led the Council of European Energy Regulators evidence on the European 2030 package. And I put back to them, yeah, but as regulators, actually, would it help to have a sense of, you know, roughly speaking, what kind of, how much renewables we might have in this, or at least what the carbon intensity of the power sector would be? I said, of course. Yeah, that would really help our regulatory decision-making and structures. Like, well, if all you have is a carbon target, nobody has a clue what they're actually trying to work towards. Because, you know, maybe it will all come from agricultural reductions or, you know, we'll expect it to be delivered through buildings' energy efficiency and we can kind of carry on business as usual in electricity regulation. So, yeah, actually, it's really helpful to know a bit more about what kind of system might we be trying to design for. And so you move fairly quickly from this abstract idea that, of course, we're all good economists, let's just have an overall target and find the least cost, to discover that in the real system, people have to know what are they trying to do. Roughly, it doesn't mean you have to say we're going to have this many gigawatts of solar and this many gigawatts of that, but to get some sense of the shape of the future you are working towards, I think is actually quite important. Now, what also follows is you need to be humble about it. You need to learn as you go along. You need to build in the expectation you will learn as you go along and therefore have regular review cycles. But I still think it's better to start with, okay, based on our current evidence, it looks like this kind of direction is going to be a good bet. We'll try and build up other options. And the UK policy has absolutely tried to build up options across renewables, CCS and nuclear. And I have to say, looks like CCS in Britain is now a bit of a dead end, at least in the way it was done. Nuclear, I'm not sure we want to repeat another Hinkley Point type contract for those who've been watching the nuclear story, which kind of leaves us with a winner out of that race, it's beginning to look like. And that's kind of the way it should be. You try various options, you develop them a certain way, you discover that some horses are running faster than others. That, to me, is decent policy.
Thanks very much, everyone, for being here. This is the kind of material that we cover in some of the master's courses that we do teach here. Professor Grubb's book is for sale. I do hope to see you back at one of our seminars next year, and please join me in thanking Michael.